So, tēnā koutou katoa.
I call Ian Liz Galloway.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Many members this evening and in the first reading debate have acknowledged the whakapapa, the history of this settlement, but I think it bears repeating as much as possible. So I want to also acknowledge the thousands of unionised care and support workers who have fought for so many years for this settlement. I remember the days of the Fair Share for Aged Care campaign. I remember attempts to form multi-employer collective agreements with different employers in the sector. I remember coming to this place with nurses and caregivers to appear before the Health Select Committee to discuss the issue. Then the unions, the unionised workers, decided to pursue legal action. That, as we know, resulted in a favourable decision for them. And finally, at that point, the government decided to come to the table, and what happened was we got that classic tripartite arrangement of government, workers and employers sitting round the table together and thrashing out a settlement that today we are in another phase of legislating for and putting into place. I think that history all needs to be acknowledged. This hasn't happened by magic. It hasn't just appeared out of thin air. It hasn't happened over the last 20 months. It hasn't happened over the last 5 years. It is the result of years and years and decades of struggle from by some of the lowest paid and most vulnerable people in the New Zealand workforce. And that should be acknowledged and should be congratulated. And it couldn't have been achieved without unions. Let's just be honest about that. Those mostly women working in the care and support workforce would not have got to where they have if they hadn't unionised, worked together, worked collectively to achieve this outcome. So I also want to acknowledge, sir, the everybody who's worked over the last couple of weeks in the Select Committee process. I'm not normally a fan of truncated Select Committee processes. I've seen them go badly in this House. I've seen the results of them be less than ideal, and I've seen this House have to come back and rectify the errors that have occurred during truncated Select Committee processes. But I have a great deal of confidence in this one for a number of reasons. One is that the legislation that the Select Committee was considering was the result of that negotiated settlement. So an awful lot of hard work and consultation had gone into getting the legislation right before it was taken to the Select Committee. The other is the astonishingly hard work that members of the Select Committee and officials for the Select Committee and support staff for the Select Committee have put into the Select Committee process, and also the quality of the submissions made by the unions and made by employers to support the Select Committee in its work. So I want to thank them for that. I was not a member of the Select Committee, but I want to thank those very hard-working members of Parliament and very hard-working officials and submitters who have played their part in making sure that this bill proceeds well. Now, the point of the Select Committee process, of course, is to make sure that the bill is fit for purpose, that it achieves its policy intent, and for submitters to raise any issues with it. And I think we do need to acknowledge in the second reading the concerns that were raised by employers around the quantum of taxpayer money that is going towards this settlement. Because I think employers did feel a little bit hoodwinked in a way. They raised concerns about how they are going to pay for holiday pay. They raised concerns about how they are going to pay for backfilling training days when staff are away training, KiwiSaver, and also issues around relativity. Other staff members, other people working in this sector who are not covered by this agreement, and what impact this agreement might have on their pay. And those are legitimate concerns that, Mr. Speaker, I have not heard one government member address. The minister didn't address them, and not one of the National Party speakers in this debate this evening has addressed those entirely legitimate concerns from employers. We as legislators have the job of passing this legislation to bring this settlement into force. The government has the job of appropriating sufficient funding to make sure that employers can pay these wages and address all the other costs that come with the settlement. That was something the government guaranteed to the employers when they were bargaining in good faith to reach this settlement. And I am saddened and feel a little bit let down, actually, by the government. Not nearly as let down as the employers feel, I'm sure. But let down by a government who have celebrated this. It's been a good process. We all feel very, very fond of this outcome. We feel very positive about this outcome. We all know it's the right thing to do. And yet the government has kind of let the side down by failing to adequately fund this settlement. And not one government member has spoken to address that issue, to allay the concerns, or even to acknowledge the concerns. And that's a failure on the part of the government members, sir. And it kind of takes the shine off the settlement, which is a bit sad, but I hope that that's an issue that can be addressed either in the remaining stage of this bill or in future appropriations. Maybe after the election and we've got a different government. We can sort that one out, sir. I just want to finish, sir, by acknowledging what other members have acknowledged, that this is not the pay equity legislation. This is legislation to bring into force a negotiated settlement between unions who had the legitimate right to represent people working in the care and support sector, ETU, the NZNO and PSA. The peak bodies representing the employers in that sector and the government. Tripartite negotiations. And look at what that has done. It has achieved a settlement that will significantly increase the pay for, I think, the most undervalued, the most seriously low-paid and vulnerable workforce in New Zealand. That is something to be celebrated, but it is something that should not be cut off in its prime. This is an industry standard agreement backed by legislation, and it is improving wages for vulnerable and low-paid workers. Let's celebrate that, and let's talk about how we can extend the benefits of such an approach to wage and pay and conditions bargaining to a much wider sector of the New Zealand workforce. I'm pleased that this national government has seen fit to participate in this process. That bodes well for the future of New Zealand's employment relations landscape, because for too long, working people have not received the benefits of productivity improvements in New Zealand. I hear the argument being made, and I actually agree with the argument, that the way to improve wages is to improve productivity. But we have to make sure that productivity benefits are properly shared. And without a robust industrial relations framework, it simply doesn't happen. And the evidence for that is the last 35 years of New Zealand industrial relations. The Employment Contracts Act. And all the efforts that have been made by governments of that party over there to weaken the bargaining position of working people, which has meant that the productivity gains that the New Zealand economy has enjoyed have not been shared with working people. Well, sir, tonight we celebrate a model of industrial relations that does share the benefits of a growing economy and a more productive economy with working people. Let's not stop here. Let's make sure that all working people get the rewards from that. So let's celebrate this. It's not been done perfectly by the government, but nothing ever will be by a National Party government. But let's celebrate what progress has been made. Let's celebrate the incredible victory for unionised people in the care and support workforce. And let's look forward to a future where more and more low-paid workers can enjoy the rewards of a growing economy through a strong industrial relations framework.
Members, this debate has concluded. The question is that the motion be agreed to. Those of that opinion will say aye.
Aye.
To the contrary, no. The ayes have it.
Care and Support Worker Pay Equity Settlement Bill, second reading.
This bill is set down for committee stage next sitting day.
Mr Speaker, point of order.
Point of order, Barbara Couriger.
I seek leave for the House to adjourn until the next sitting day as we've made good progress.
Leave is sought for that purpose. Is there any objection? There is no objection. Then, members, the House stands adjourned until 2 p.m. tomorrow. Good evening.